All right, I'm Russell Shapiro, and I'm interviewing Allan Koltin today. Allan hardly needs an introduction. I'll say a few things. Top 25 thought leaders, I don't know how many years, CPA practice advisor, most influential in the accounting profession, accounting today, again, decades, I think, most recommended consultant, 18 years. Inside Public Accounting, CPA Practice Advisor, and AAM's Hall of Fame. The bottom line is Allan is the preeminent consulting to the accounting industry. He's also a friend and confidant of mine. And we've done this once before, and the idea is to help educate people in the accounting and people interested in the accounting profession about what's going on. And so thank you for agreeing to sit down with me again, Allan.
Russ, it's my pleasure, and thanks for having me. This is our annual thing. Maybe we'll keep doing this each year. And kudos to you on all the things you become the go-to attorney, the law firm, and in the accounting space. I know you've got a whole business of representing other kinds of businesses and entities, but you have become probably the most sought-after attorney when there's an M&A deal to be had. Of all sizes.
Thank you, Allan.
You and your team just do amazing work.
Thank you. Thank you. So just to talk a little bit about you for a few minutes, you came from humble beginnings. You were a junior accountant, a local CPA firm, if I remember correctly. It was Friesbitten, Eisenstein, something and something.
Yep.
And I think you tell a story, but maybe it'd be good just to repeat it a little bit here that, you know, that maybe accounting wasn't your forte. And you found something else to do instead at that firm. Maybe it was created by you. What is the background there?
Well, as the story goes, my love was marketing.
Yeah.
But mom and dad said, you know, if you're not smart enough to be a doctor, at least be a lawyer. And if you can't be either, at least be an accountant, because God knows you always have a job.
Yeah.
Boy, were they right about that. I thought I was doing pretty well my first 6 months. Matter of fact, I thought I was going to get promoted from staff to senior. Got summoned into the managing partner's office, and he said, how do you think you're doing? I said, I think I'm doing great. What do you think? And he went in his desk drawer, and he took out the partnership agreement, and he threw it at me, and he said, why don't you take a look at paragraph 16? When I look at paragraph 16, and it talks about mandatory retirement at age 65, not about how to become a new partner. And I said to him, I think you got the wrong paragraph. He said, no, I got the right one. You asked me how long it should take for me to go from staff to senior. And based on our age 65 mandatory retirement, I don't think you'll make it. He says, I got good news and bad news. He says, the bad news is you're fired. You're the worst accountant I've ever seen. He says, the good news is I'm going to hire you back on Monday. And I said, as what? He says, I don't know. I need the weekend to figure that out. Fortunately, it was really getting brought into the management and running of the business. And at a very young age, they sort of pulled me out of the debits and credits and said, you know what? This person can help us grow the business. I was the first marketing director, first business development officer, assistant to the managing partner. And little did I know what I was really doing was taking an MBA class on how to consult to build a successful accounting firm. Thank you.
And then you started Practice Development Institute.
PDI was an outgrowth of the accounting firm. We were spending all this money on marketing. We were the country's fastest growing firm in the 80s and 90s. And we said, you know what? Other firms need this stuff. So we had a publishing division that created the niche newsletters, industry service line. We had training and leadership and business development. And we had, I'd call them technical courses on how to migrate from being a compliance provider to a profit improvement consultant or strategic planner, things like that.
Yeah, so thank you for that background. Yeah,
thank you.
I see this beautiful chess set here. I didn't know that you were quite involved in chess as a youngster. Just say what you told me earlier about chess.
The truth is, in those days, which is a long time ago, Bobby Fischer was the one we all aspired to be. My brother, Howie, older brother, was a nationally ranked champ. He took me under his wing, and lo and behold, I won the Wisconsin Chess Championship for consecutive years, way back between the ages of 5 and 10. I competed on the national circuit, and You know, in those days, that was a game. And what I loved about it, I don't know if you saw Queen's Gambit or not,
I did.
Is it taught that. You, the game teaches you how to think strategically mm-hmm. in an unknown universe. You know, the way they used to teach us, we, a little bit like the movie, you saw, you close your eyes, you see 64 squares, mm-hmm. and you learn to dream. You learn to dream and anticipate what the other side's going to do.
Yeah. And it can really be out ahead.
Yes, yes. So you're never just thinking about the next move. You're thinking about the next 3-4 moves, and you're thinking about the variations of what the opponent could be doing.
That's strategy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Thank
you. Yeah, maybe we'll play a game of chess. So.
I'm not that strategic, I guess. So actually, we had this last talk about 18 months ago. I look back at it, and it was before that there had yet been a PE deal. And you had said it was coming. And I'm like, oh, really? You sure? You know, I've heard this story before. And well, boy, were you right. We're going to talk about that a lot. But before we go there, I just want to just sort of give an overview of what's going on, you know, just regular business-wise. And then we're going to spend a lot of time on M&A and then PE as a material part of M&A. But let me just ask you just to lay the groundwork a little bit about, like, how is business for 2022? Kind of for 2021 was an incredible year, better than anyone thought, blah, blah, blah. Okay. How was 2022?
So I'm going to give you the answer, the general answer, always exceptions. You know, sometimes I'll make a statement and someone says, well, the sky must be falling because that wasn't us. You know, these are businesses. They're at different life cycles. They're in different markets, different service lines. You can't give one universal answer. But if I focused on the, you know, what we'll call the top 500 firms of maybe 5 million or more, which is where we spend most of our time, it was, in the words of Larry David, a pretty, pretty good year. 2020, as we talked about, was a really good year. But I think firms knew, you know, take 15 months of revenue, put it into 12, don't spend money. If you couldn't make money in 2020, maybe look for another profession. 2021 was tweaking of the 2020 playbook. 2022, from what I can see financially, bottom line will be the best year ever for most firms, but it will also have been the most painful year. And you know where the pain is. The pain is the inability to find and keep talent. And that's not going away. So great year with an asterisk. See my dog Bucky here laying and sleeping, but they work like dogs. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's for them, they don't believe is a sustainable model. Russ Moore, 55-year-olds, burnt out than I've ever seen before, mm-hmm. saying, I don't wanna wait till 65, I wanna be done now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to go through this torture anymore. So it's an interesting year, a torturous year, but a great year financially. Go figure.
And do you see 2023 being similar or?
I do. I mean, you know, people say like, oh, there's a recession, watch out. Well, you know what? 2020, I think the first 6 months was a recession and we had our best year ever. As the wisdom of my mom and dad in 1980, always be an accountant because you'll always have a job in good and bad times. And I know we'll talk more about private equity, but I think that's one of the big attractions. They see an industry that up to a point is recession-proof.